I'm joined here today for the vote by Keith Burstein, and we're going to. You write operas. You're kind of politically engaged in a way, but not heavily engaged is probably the way to put it. Is that right?
Yeah, I find there's a sort of fine balance, you know, that has to be maintained between if you're trying to do artistic work that kind of processes political material or uses it in some way. It's quite a fine line between actually keeping your focus on doing that and then actually being drawn into actual politics.
Yes.
They, funnily enough, they're not really ultimately entirely compatible, I don't think.
Yeah.
Also for the credibility of your work, you know, you don't want to be seen as party political. You know, you, the closest you can get is to politics is with a small p, I would say.
Yes, because why is that? Why do people that go to the opera, they don't like to kind of see political themes in operas, or what? Where's that come from? Because in plays, for example, there are.
Yeah,
it's a theme, isn't it? In other art forms, it is part of the content.
No, I mean there is actually a tradition of writers of opera veering towards politics. You know, Verdi was the opera composer. Verdi was very involved in the Italian reunification, and the Marriage of Figaro by Mozart has a bit of a whiff of the French Revolution about it, you know, and the Ring Cycle of Richard Wagner actually has been given a Marxist interpretation by a French director called Chéreau, I think, at Bayreuth in Germany. You know, there's a whole production that just interpreted it as the gods, the Nibelung, the underworld, the gods, you know, so opera actually does have a tradition of venturing into politics. But I think what you don't want to feel is that it at any point has become propaganda.
Yes.
You know, where it's just really the servant of some dogma. You know, at that point, you've really lost your credibility as an artist, you know, I think. So
yes.
It's a fine line.
And so your latest play is Prometheus's Revolution, is that right?
The Prometheus Revolution.
Prometheus Revolution.
Yeah.
It was in Brighton, wasn't it, for the Labour Party conference? So
yeah.
How did it go down?
Well, I think, I mean, you know, it's an interesting example of what we were just saying.
Yes.
Because, you know, while the Corbyn project is perceived to be rightly a radical project, whether they want to actually be seen as a revolution, you know, is another matter. And so I think, I get healthy interest. I mean, John McDonnell actually came to the premiere of the Prometheus Revolution and put out a really lovely tweet about it. Because the ideals expressed in the opera, which is just the equality of each and every human being, the equal worth of everyone, you know, is basically perhaps a summary of the vision of the opera, which actually, if you really follow it through and put it into action, would have to overcome so many class prejudices, racism, you know, to really become reality. So in fact, the opera actually looks at what it would take to actually bring about that, and it discovers that it would take a load of suffering. So, I mean, I was very careful when I wrote it that it wasn't perceivable as a party political propaganda.
And what's it about in kind of general terms?
Well, it imagines using the Prometheus myth, which is this myth of from ancient Greece, of the hero who had the audacity to steal the fire of the gods, and who seemed to be the sole owners of the power of fire, which is in itself a sort of metaphor for life, I suppose, or life-giving energy, mm-hmm. And to give that power to the mortals. So, in other words, to the human race.
Yeah.
And the gods were outraged by this and punished Prometheus horribly. So I took that myth as a kind of metaphor for where perhaps we are politically, you know, at this moment, which is that the idea of elite seems to be being challenged from all sorts of angles.
Yes.
And the elite concentration of power and wealth. And what would happen if, as I was just saying, a movement arose that actually wanted to do what Prometheus did, you know, and take that power from the concentration and give it to everybody. So I imagined a present-day scenario in which, actually, in the imaginary world of the opera, which is perhaps in a hypothetical near future to us, someone who actually was a radical as a youth, as we so often are in our youth, but then sort of departed from that and went to the City of London and made a vast amount of money, and therefore has connections with that world as well, is drawn back when the country falls into a form of chaos, which we can feel the embryonic beginnings of even now in reality. You know, so a bit like now, where you begin to wonder who's in charge. Is it the Prime Minister? Is it the courts? Is it the Parliament? Is it... And this sort of country that goes through this kind of meltdown, but much worse than now.
Yes.
You know, combined with a major kind of collapse of the financial system, combined with a kind of rising of an Occupy movement-type movement, which in the opera is called the Prometheus Peace Movement, and that's where ostensibly the title of the opera comes from. And Peter, who is this billionaire, self-made billionaire, is drawn back towards the peace movement that he co-founded in the circumstance of this political chaos, and indeed sees that as the only way to probably save the financial coherence of the world that he's part of, because it's just all collapsing. And he transfers £2 trillion into the bank account of the Prometheus Peace Movement, which is this kind of Promethean moment where all the power is transferred from the city, all that concentration of power and wealth from a time of 1% of 1% of 1% of the population, suddenly is put into the hands notionally of everyone. And that triggers a kind of inversion of values. So suddenly our society, instead of being based, as arguably it is, based on war, and basically around war, because, you know, if you look at human history, all we do is just kill and fight each other, and unbelievably horrible ways. That seems to be what the Homo sapien is programmed to do. And suddenly, the basis of society, as I say, is arguably armaments, which is huge. You know, we sell loads of armaments to Saudi Arabia, and then they bomb Yemen, and we don't somehow make the moral equation that, wait a minute, we're enabling this. And so the values of society itself are inverted, so that instead of being based on war and destruction and these concentrations of greed, suddenly the values become humanity and compassion and altruism.
With all of that, are you saying that capitalism in general kind of creates those values and that kind of attitude towards humanity? So what are you calling for in this opera? Is there a kind of a hidden message in there, or hidden messages?
I think it's more a question of sensing that we are on the threshold of some sort of collective perception to do with what is this world actually about? You know, is it for the concentration of wealth and then a kind of slavery of everybody else? Or is there a collective well-being? And it's not really, it's not a Marxist idea or a dogma or Labour or Tory, or it's just, I think you can feel across the board, actually, that there is a kind of a question going on. And the climate change, interestingly, Extinction Rebellion seemed to have kind of, for the moment, encapsulated this.
Yes. I was going to say, because what these kind of movements you're talking about, what they require is almost like the middle class to get on board, don't they, for it to be driven forward. Is that right? Is that what we need there? Is that what, what did Occupy... Did the movement work in the end? I mean, it created some change. It kind of created momentum, as we're going to discuss later. Yeah. But what do you need for that kind of revolution to work? And can we get finer answers in art forms such as opera?
Well, I think, as you implied, I think it is often said that revolutions are often led by middle-class intellectuals, isn't it? Look at Lenin and so on, and Marx and Engels, you know. Yeah, I think there's some truth in that. I mean, when I was sort of a bit involved with the fringes of momentum when it began, you know, right from the beginning. And that was a very interesting sort of moment. And I did notice that a lot of the people who were running that movement did seem to have, you know, very smart accents and seemed to be very well-heeled people. And I sort of thought, wait a minute, you know, how come you lot are kind of running this sort of what's supposed to be like a revolution of the people? This doesn't seem to work. And I noticed one of them had put on Facebook he was a carpenter. And I sort of looked, when I met him, I sort of thought, you're no carpenter, you know, what school did you go to? So it was kind of...
I've seen this at first hand for myself as well. And that is really interesting.
Yeah.
I've completely seen that many, many a time.
And I mean, my theory is, which may or may not be correct, but was that the Occupy movement, they came up with this meme or this idea that with these concentrations of wealth are the 1% of the 1%. And then what that meant was that people who actually previously thought of themselves and other people thought of them as extraordinarily affluent people, actually now for the first time got this idea that, no, I'm not sort of rich with the super rich. Yeah. And I'm a sort of aspirant person who's all part of that incredibly glamorous world of the very rich. I'm actually with the poor. And yes. The continuum is from the sort of beggar in the street to me. And then there's this unbridgeable gap between me yes. to the super rich.
OK, we'll just leave it there for now. Join us for the second half. We're going to be speaking to Kiefer a lot more about political movements in the UK and kind of art forms which express some of the ideas within those political movements. So join us shortly for the second half. Welcome back to The Vote. I'm here with Keith Burstein, who's an opera writer and also a political activist. Not massively engaged, but you're engaged enough to talk to know about the foundations of Momentum, which you were involved in at the start. Yeah. So we were talking about kind of the people that help set up Momentum, and they're not always the kind of working class hero types, are they? There's a broad church there, isn't there, within Momentum?
There is a broad church, but I think amongst the people who were running it, you know, I would say it did sort of stretch a lot into the sort of middle and upper middle class, you know. And I think what happened actually was that with the Occupy movement, which was an international movement, you know, it wasn't just here. If you remember, it started, yes. I think, started in New York.
Yeah.
And it sort of spread everywhere, here in Tokyo, it's just all over the place. Where you got these sort of encampments of people. And they were, the extraordinary thing about those encampments was that they were like sort of little universities, seminars. And so there was this very sort of almost kind of middle class feel about it. And I think what happened was that the children of the upper middle class got radicalized at that point. And they then went on to form Momentum and here, for instance, form, you know, the sort of the Corbyn movement. They fed into it. But I mean, that is actually a genuine, you know, on the ground movement. And it brings in, you have support all yes. over the country across all the whole sort of economic spectrum.
Yes,
but I do think that it, you know, I think the middle classes got radicalised, you know, at that point. And then you look at the Extinction Rebellion, the same, you know, if
yes.
you go on there.
And they're willing to kind of get a criminal record for it and to kind of disrupt
yes.
their everyday
yeah.
life in order to achieve that
yes.
bigger aim.
And their parents feel that they're down with the kids, you know, and they're terribly cool and rebellious. Mm. So they can have it both ways. They can have their 5-bedroom house and feel that they're revolutionaries.
Yes. My theory as well as within that movement is that the housing crisis has played a big part in it. People expecting to get in the housing at the moment, late 20s, early 30s, and that's not happening now. And that's
yeah.
people are asking questions why that's not happening.
Right.
And that's a big moment in life, isn't it? You know, purchasing your first house, it used to be a big moment, and it used to be an expectation that, you know, maybe you'd go to university, get a house, and that's been disrupted, hasn't it? And people are asking questions.
Yeah.
Where's that wealth gone? Because a lot of our wealth is tied up in housing and in pensions, in fact, the majority of it, but not everyone's got a slice of it.
Yeah, which is extremely dispossessing of a person. You know, they just feel their own, basically their own society doesn't house them in
yes.
any way.
Yeah.
You know, they can neither sort of be aspirational in that way and get a mortgage. Because the inflation of house prices from the sort of massive injection of sort of investors from abroad, you know, hugely inflating artificially the market, means that just the ordinary young person can't buy. Or nor is there any, you know, the social housing hasn't been built either sufficient to, you know, give you a nice council flat. Or so there's just this, yes, I think across the board, there's just this feeling of deep discontent. Of what have I done wrong? You know, I can't even have a house.
Yes, exactly. Where's that going to lead to then, do you think, in the future? Where do you see Momentum going? The Occupy movement, that's kind of fizzled out and it's been overtaken by Momentum. And I mean, we've had in the latest TV studio, The World Transformed, which is a big movement as well during a Labour Party conference, over, I think, 10 different sites in Brighton
yeah.
over the conference period. So there's a lot of, there's kind of the foot soldiers there, there's the kind of the movement, but where, how's that going to lead to political change? I guess they need the government machinery to work, in which case they need probably Jeremy Corbyn or someone like Jeremy Corbyn to get into power.
Well, I would have thought so, yes. I mean, you know, there are signs that the Tories are being kind of, because I think Corbyn movement has made the political weather in this country. ever since he became leader of the Labour Party.
Some of his policies have been stolen as well, haven't they, by other parties. So.
Well, and Boris Johnson is, you know, in the sort of slither of time that he's got between sort of suspending democracy and whatever else he's doing. He has been desperately trying to park his tanks on the Corbyn lawn, you know.
Because, yes.
Which is, you know, they say imitation is the highest form of flattery, don't they? So, and that's what tends... And, I mean, May did that as well, if you think back to her sort of doorstep speech, you know, when she said, I can't, you know, we can't accept the sort of the number of young black people who are incriminated in this country.
Yeah.
Disproportionately, but she didn't do anything about it, as far as I know. But because he all got caught up in Brexit. But yeah, I think, I mean, you know, for anything to change, I think we probably would have to have a relatively radical figure like Corbyn. But whether he'll ever get, you know, be allowed to take up residence in 10 Downing Street is not a matter.
Do you see change happening anyway? We were talking off air about, I was talking about, you know, Generation Rent, that there's a lot of people now that looking to get the housing ladder and they're kind of, they're, avenues are getting closed off, so they're going to be active. They're not going to be voting for parties which don't support people that want to improve conditions for renters. So is there going to be change anyway, because that's where all the votes are, and, you know, that seems to be what counts in the end?
I would hope so, yes. But, I mean, obviously there is a limit to how far, for instance, the Tory establishment can actually compromise their own kind of values. So whether they will actually be drawn across that line, you know, it remains to be seen. And indeed, whether a Corbyn government, you know, how radical that will really be.
Yes.
I mean, the fact that John McDonnell came to my opera, I think, is a good sign. You know, an opera about a revolution. And certainly, you know, if you speak to sort of more right-wing people or members of the Tory establishment, they are, you know, in absolutely terrified, I think, of what it might mean if the Corbyn government actually came about.
Yeah. Do we need Brexit to happen for political change to... the political change you're looking at, does Brexit need to come first? Because, obviously, up north, there's a lot of people voted for Brexit.
Yeah.
So people... If Brexit doesn't happen, then people lose faith in politics and they don't vote at all, do they? And some of these votes that people like Jeremy Corbyn might need won't be forthcoming because people are disenfranchised or they feel that they're disenfranchised. Where does Brexit fit into this?
It's very complicated, isn't it? Brexit has cut across all of this.
Yeah.
And suddenly, you know, whatever persuasion you were before, you find yourself sort of in bed with whoever on your side was someone that you previously despised, you know, so of the argument, if you know what I mean. So it's very, very complicated. But I mean, I do think that if Brexit is not done, then yes, as you imply, I think there's a huge deficit, you know, on the sort of democratic deficit, they call it, don't they?
Mm.
Is just that, you know, I think it's a mistake to underestimate how important the democratic principle is to our society.
Yes.
You know, it's very recently won. I mean, my mum was born in 1920, so she didn't even have, you know, women didn't even have the vote properly when my mum was born. You know, think about that.
Yeah.
That shows how fragile and surface our democracy is, and yet it's become the defining agent of what our whole political kind of culture is supposed to be. So if we just, if it turns out you get a vote you don't like, you just say, oh, I don't like that, so we'll actually just reverse that or overturn it or ignore it, I think that is incredibly dangerous.
Yes.
That doesn't mean that I in any way support, you know, Boris Johnson suspending Parliament. And so I think that was also a terrible mistake, which we now see the beginning of the consequences of. To do, you can't defend democracy by suspending democracy. So democracy is this kind of irreducible principle, I think.
Yes. Do you see the political parties aligning again, more coalition governments in the future? Liberal Democrats, they want to revoke Article 50 if they win an overmajority. Is that going to make it difficult for the kind of the Remainer parties, which do outweigh the Leaver parties, if you add up all the votes?
Mm.
Is there going to be like this so-called progressive alliance in the future?
Well,
or do you... Because it would mean single candidates standing in seats whereby some people are going to lose out, aren't they? So does that selfish instinct come out and the parties say, no, we're going to field their own candidates in each of the seats?
I mean, I think Corbyn, to his credit, has really, you know, has reached out and has tried to form a notional alliance. But then, as you say, when you get the Lib Dems suddenly sort of compromising their own principles by sort of, you know, just saying they'll just revoke, I think that's very difficult as well.
Yeah.
I think, as I was saying, I think the only safe way is to just follow this principle of democracy. And I think out of necessity, yes, some sort of so-called progressive alliance may well just be more or less forced, you know, one way or another, to form itself, resistant to what seems like an extremely draconian right-wing government. I mean, another terrible risk of, you know, ignoring the Brexit vote is that actually you drive politics further and further to the right. That's been my fear. You know, I've been looking at what happened in Germany, you know, remembering what happened in Germany in the 1930s.
Yes, you know, with the BBC documentary Rise of the Nazis, which is very good.
Yeah. Which just seemed very timely, you know, because that whole process of discontent being used by the Nazi Party to actually use the democratic system to kind of get, you know, harness that discontent and get people to vote for them. And then having got a bit of power, they begin to close down the democratic system behind them. And, you know, the closing of Parliament felt really like the Enabling Act in Germany that Hitler used. You know, it gave him absolute power as an authoritarian figure. And, I mean, in theory, you could just prorogue Parliament all year round. You know, that can't be right.
Yeah, exactly. I do agree, yeah. Thanks for coming in, Keith. We'll catch up again soon, no doubt, and all the best in the future. Thanks. Goodbye.